In November of 2009, after the Fame Monster came out, Lady Gaga met with me for an on-the-record to discuss everything. In a lengthy interview, Gaga talked about her music, her sexuality, and her support for gay rights. What you're about to see are the lost tapes from that interview, the unreleased footage, where she discusses her parents, President Obama, her typical day, her struggle not to be a control freak, and the death of Michael Jackson. It's the second part of a rare one-on-one with music's hottest young superstar. This is Lady Gaga on the record with Fuse, The Lost Tapes.
Anyone can be famous. My music is very soulful. My religion is my music. I'm obsessed with monsters. I've worked hard since I was very young. You don't tell me what I want to hear. Tell me the truth.
Bobby Brown said people get into the music business for two reasons. To show off their talent, like Whitney Houston did, or to be the life of the party, like Bobby did. Which are you?
I'm neither of those things.
So what are you?
I got into the music business to liberate. I want to liberate the world. My art is liberation.
From what?
From whatever it is that's chaining you or imprisoning you or making you feel like a freak sometimes and like you don't fit in. My shows, my music, it's all part of a performance art piece that's designed to liberate. Mainstream America and mainstream music around the world, that was my challenge. But that's why I've never given up. That's why I've insisted I have to bleed to death for 4 minutes. I have to do it this way. My video must say this. It's staying in my space and not trying to react to what's going on around me, but just staying here.
It's tough.
Well, it's tough if the ideas stop, but that's why you have to listen to the voices. My religion is my music, so when it comes, that's something I'm really diligent about is my visions. And I know I might sound like some, you know, overly spiritual artist, but in truth, I would just be nothing without my spirituality. And it's my visions that carry through to my records.
And the bleeding at the VMAs? What were you saying there?
Like I said about visions, I have these visions about what I need to say and what comes next. And I had this vision of Frida Kahlo, the paintings, and she was bleeding from her heart. Thought about Madame Butterfly. And then I thought about what my obsession was when I was in high school, which was beautiful actresses and models and singers that died.
Like who?
Marilyn Monroe, Judy Garland, Sylvia Plath, JonBenet Ramsey. We never really saw what happened to these women. We just heard about it because somehow the enigma of their existence was encapsulated. So I wanted to say a few things with this performance. Here it is. Here's the image that you're all wondering about.
I mean, I love that you are a complete artist. You're doing these great performances and you're giving us great records and you're giving us all this fashion. You know, it's a full thing.
Well, it's performance art. That's what makes me different. You know, I'm not just a pop singer. I'm not just a writer. I'm a designer. I designed my stage set with the House of Gaga for the Monster Ball. The clothing, you know, it's fashion, but it's avant-garde. And it's an actual piece that's meant to be a commentary on something else.
Oh, interesting.
So it's all, you know, I think about everything I do.
Interesting. I mean, we can tell that you think about every aspect of what you do, but I was wondering why there's so many face-obscuring outfits and hats, and, I mean, why is that?
It's part of my work. It's part of my work.
What's your average day like? When do you get up? When do you go to sleep? What are some of your rituals that you do every day?
I wake up and I get ready for my day. I have a book I like to read, which I won't tell you what it is. I work all day long. I'm a control freak, but I try not to be. I try to trust, but I have a hand in everything I do. And I want it to be a very clear aesthetic that's almost propaganda, so that when you see the image, it's Gaga. Whether it's a video or it's a song or I'm live in front of you, it's Gaga.
Do you feel like a freak nowadays?
Well, no, I'm very comfortable in my work, and as a performance artist, I'm very deeply half satisfied and half dissatisfied all the time with what I'm putting out. That's the nature of being an artist. But in the beginning, it was like a boxing match, and I felt like Rocky because I was coming out of a commercial market that wants me to roll around in grease and touch myself and look like all the girls in the magazines, and I've never really conformed to that.
What about high school?
I felt like a freak in school and growing up, and I was uncomfortable because I was in a uniform and I didn't really fit in, and I was a really good student, but I was a bad kid, if that makes any sense. So, like, teachers wanted to be mad at me, but they couldn't because I aced all my tests. But when I went home, I used to put makeup on at the house. My mother would say, how you going, kid? And I'd say, well, you know, what do you think of Marilyn today? Or, I did Judy Garland today, Mom. And it was my way of expressing myself. There's no separation between the girl that my mother gave birth to and Gaga today. You resign yourself to your work and you fully 100% become it.
So, I mean, it was always in you, but where did the Gaga-ness of you come from?
You know, that's the question I always say. You know, when they ask you, like, if you could ask your favorite artist of all time one thing, what would you ask them? And I always say I would ask John Lennon where he got his nerve. That's kind of what you're asking me. And I don't know. I don't know where my nerve came from. In the society that we live in, if a male artist were to come in here right now and say, I've got all these number ones and I'm taking over the world, you know, you probably wouldn't challenge him too much. But for women, it's a bit of a struggle. I've sold almost 5 million albums and I'm still fighting. Like, I'm on Just Dance. So ever since my career began, I've actually made an effort to stay out of the public eye as much as possible. There was a moment where I just couldn't escape, but now I've really tightened things up, so I'm sort of in hiding, in a way, to protect the music.
You are all in.
I'm all in.
You say, I like it rough. Like what?
I think in that song, which was a B-side on The Fame, it was about masochistic behavior and love and addictive behavior, going back to people that aren't good for you. I like it rough.
Yeah, yeah.
But I've kind of moved on from that, and I'm in a more particular space. That's why The Fame Monster is with The Fame. I want everyone to see the yin and yang, and the transformation, and the change, and the progression of the artist. Each song represents a definite, true part of myself, and I wanted it to be halfway in between my previous work and a departure, something new and bigger. And dance music, I think, has been a bit convoluted in the U.S. now.
What do you mean?
If you can dance to it, it's dance music. But I know what real dance music is. Right. So this record has got some real dance records on it. I want your drama, the torture you hate.
Your dad had surgery. He's feeling better, you said. How's that going?
He's doing great.
Yeah?
I'm really happy.
You said he's your hero?
He is my hero.
And he's feeling good?
He's like a 17-year-old boy with a new heart.
And you wrote Speechless about him?
Yeah. I wrote it to convince him to have this surgery. And it took a little more than that to convince him, but the song definitely helped. And now I have my dad to hold my babies and walk me down the aisle. I mean, each song represents one in particular, but they kind of collide and meet. Teeth, for example, is my fear of the truth. I say, tell me something that'll save me. I need a man that makes me all right. You know, I'm sick of being with guys that tell me what I want to hear. Tell me, you know, stop feeding me bull. Tell me the truth.
You're a daddy's girl, right?
I'm a both mommy and daddy's. I'm Italian, so I worship my parents.
You've talked about to other people that, you know, if your dad did not approve, then you would have to change, right?
It's not that I would have to change. It's just that it genuinely affects me in a very deep way, and it would upset me. Whereas when, you know, some random person says something, it doesn't really mean anything. But my dad, for sure.
But you've won him over to loving Gaga-ness.
He loves my work.